Well, good morning, Canton. As Mark said, my name is Rick, and I am on staff at Oak Point Novi. And yes, it is also true that I was your pastor's college roommate. At one point, we lived together, we worked together, we even slept in the same room, we had meals together, we would do ministry together. I mean, there is a point of time where we were spending, I would say, upwards to 18 to 20 hours a day with one another. And so just as much dirt that Mark has on me, I also have on him. And so if you really want to get to know your pastor quickly, come find me after service, and I would love to chat with you about that. I think it's super cool that today is your Ezra 8 day, your anniversary. I remember sitting about 6 months before you guys launched right over here as Mark was kind of showing a few of us this theater and just thinking God is going to do something special in this place. And it's fun to see all of you gather here in person and online just a short 2 years later. I love that we get to be here together. And we are wrapping up our series called One Hit Wonders, where we've been looking at some of the books that have only one chapter to them, and they are not one-hit wonders in terms of they don't have any importance. They just don't maybe get the same kind of attention that some of the other books of the Bible get. And as I was kind of watching over some of the past messages, I noticed that Mark talked about some of the one-hit wonder songs that there were. And one of the things that my mind immediately went to was not necessarily songs, but the movies that have sequels that maybe should have been one-hit wonders. You guys know what I'm talking about? Like those movies that you were so excited for the sequel because the first one was so good, and then you saw the sequel and you were like, why would you do this? All right, like why? Like a couple that came to my mind was the movie Frozen. If you have any kids, right, and you have to have an anthem playing in your house at all time, like why did they have to give us another one, right? Like we've already endured so much together with Let It Go. Like why do I need to learn about Atta Holland as well? Maybe the movie The Karate Kid is on your list, right? I remember thinking like it ended so strong. Like Danny LaRusso is the champ, you know, and I know that there's like a whole TV show about it now, which is great for memory lane, but I remember thinking like Karate Kid 2 didn't stand up to Karate Kid 1, and just logistically, like, you know, doesn't at some point he have to become a karate man at some point? Grease, do you guys remember Grease? Like this movie, like that there's 35-year-olds playing teenagers, and it's weird anyways, and then they say like, hey, we're going to get a whole new crop of, you know, 40-year-olds playing teenagers again, like, and it just didn't work well. Or I just saw just yesterday that Jason Momoa, that's right, Aquaman, has signed on to Fast and Furious 10. 10, friends, like 10. They have made 10 of these movies, and people are still watching them, all right? Now, one movie that I'm glad stayed a one-hit wonder because it is perfect in its original iteration is the movie Elf, right? I mean, like, aren't we so glad that the movie Elf wasn't ruined by Elf 2? And so, right, these are these things that sometimes when you have just this original, it's just perfect as it is. And I really believe that in much of these letters, there's power in the original letter, the one chapter that we get from these guys. And today we're going to be looking at Jude. And Jude is a one chapter book that's the only letter that we have written by Jude in Scripture. And it is a tiny little book that's found right before the last book of the Bible, Revelation. So it's sometimes I feel like Jude doesn't get the power, the attention that it should, because it's this powerful book that's found right before like one of the most confusing books in the Bible. And so everyone always wants to know about the end of the world, the end times. And so they skip over Jude. But together today, we're going to see that this small book has incredible power for you and for me as we live out our faith. So if you have your Bibles and you guys want to follow along, you guys can open up to Jude. And as you open up to Jude, I want to just kind of introduce you to this guy who wrote this book. Now, Jude is actually not his real name. I know it's a little weird, but his name is actually Judah in Hebrew or Judas in Greek. And Jude, or Judas, was one of Jesus' brothers. We learn about this in Matthew 13, and we know that Jesus had four brothers. We know about Jacob, we know about Joseph, we know about Simon, and we know about Judas, or Jude. And what's interesting about Jesus' brothers is that they did not follow Jesus while Jesus was alive. But after Jesus rose from the dead, all of his brothers began to follow Jesus. They became disciples of Jesus, and they didn't just simply become disciples, but they became leaders in the church, and they became missionaries. Now, it's one of those things, right? I often think about this. Like, it's funny to me that Jesus' brothers didn't follow him on earth, because we all know that our families know the tough stuff about our lives, right? Our families have seen us in some of the worst spots where we are, right? Like, I would never want my siblings to tell you about some of the stuff that I, or some of the ways that I acted as a teenager. And I got to imagine that some of this was going through Jesus's brothers' minds. Like, oh yeah, you're the Messiah. Okay. I saw what you did. You know, I saw, you know, about all these things, right? But then he rose from the dead. And if someone says that they're going to rise from the dead and then actually does it, like, they're probably someone who you should follow. And I think that's what Jesus' brothers began to understand. And so they became leaders and disciples and missionaries. And Jude, he became a missionary and began to go and travel around the area telling people about his brother Jesus. And one of the interesting things is that we see in his writings that he has a deep knowledge of the Old Testament and other Hebrew literature. And he was writing to a community of believers that also had a deep knowledge of these writings. We don't know specifically the church that Jude was writing to, but we know that it was likely made up of Jewish followers of Jesus because of the assumption of their understanding of the Old Testament that he builds off of. And Jude has a very specific reason for writing this letter, and it's found in Jude verse 3. Here's what it says. It says, "Dear friends, although I was very eager to write to you about the salvation that we share, I felt compelled to write and urge you to contend for the faith that was once and for all entrusted to God's holy people." You see, Jude says, hey, I wanted to write to you a letter of encouragement where you would feel kind of encouraged to continue to follow Jesus, to go deeper in your faith. But instead, I felt like I needed to write to you to contend for your faith. What Jude is telling the church is that our faith is worth fighting for. And so Jude, he's telling the church, this is not just something to fight for. This is the most important thing to fight for, to contend for. And then what he does for the rest of this letter is he lays out how we can contend or fight for our faith. And the very first thing that he does is he challenges the church to know the foundation of their faith. To know the foundation of their faith. You know, Jude, he actually, before he even starts off stating why he wrote the letter, he begins to anchor the whole meaning of this letter, the whole purpose of this letter, in the very first two verses. And it's in those first two verses that we see the importance of knowing where our faith comes from. Right? And it's important for all of us to know where our faith comes from. This is not like a hot dog where we just kind of like expect, like, we don't, no one asks the question, right? The other summer, I think it was not this past summer, the summer before that, my kids were in this kind of interesting, like, they were beginning to discover stuff, right? And so they asked me a simple question, like, Dad, are hamburgers made out of ham? And I was like, no, they're not. They're made out of cows, blah, blah, blah. And so we were going through this. And at one point later in the summer, we were having hot dogs. And we were eating hot dogs. And my one daughter, my oldest, she took the hot dog and she was starting to eat it. And she stopped like mid-chew. And she was like, Dad, are hot dogs made out of dogs? And I was like, no, honey, they're not made out of dogs. Now, thank you, Lord, that she did not ask the follow-up question of like, well, then what are hot dogs made out of, right? And she said, oh, good, and then just ate her hot dog. And I was like, okay, good, all right? But like, this is kind of one of those things. Like, no one asks that question. If you've ever lived on the East Coast, like, no one asks what Scrapple is made out of, all right? If you don't know what Scrapple is, you can Google it afterwards, and I'm sorry. But it's one of those things, like, so many times people don't ask these questions about where things come from, but Jude, what he does is he says the very first verses of his letter, he lets us know where our faith comes from. Here's what he says in verses 1 and 2. He says, Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and a brother of James. This is where we discover who it is that is writing to us. He says, to those who have been called, to those who are loved in God the Father and kept for Jesus Christ, mercy, peace and love be yours in abundance. You see, Jude, he says that the foundation of your faith is that you are called, you are loved, and you are kept. And I think one of the challenges that we all have in our faith is that we have to continuously fight against this notion that we are the source of our faith, right? Because in our Americanized culture, we think like, well, I'm the one who put my faith in Jesus, and I'm the one who came to him, and I'm the one. And what we forget, and Jude is reminding us, is that it is God who is drawing us close to him. And what I think is interesting is he starts off with these three verbs here. And actually, only one of them is an active verb, and it's this verb of called. And I think what's cool about this little language thing that we don't see in the English, but we see in the Greek, is that what Jude is saying is that our calling is central to our faith. That God called us and allows us by his calling to freely respond to the gospel. And this is central to who we are as followers of Jesus. We have been called by God to himself. And we are loved, right? We did not love God, but instead God first loved us. And we are kept, right? We are not the ones that are kind of holding our faith together, but instead God is the one who is keeping us. This word actually means to protect, to keep from harm, or to preserve. God is the one who is keeping us and preserving us from harm as we walk with him and live out our faith. And so, friends, we need to know that we have a foundational faith. We have a foundation that is significant in our lives and the faith that we live out. And the question that I naturally had as I was looking at this, well, okay, then do we have a role in our faith? Because if it's God who is doing all these things, the answer is a resounding absolutely. We have a role. Our faith is initiated by God because of his love, and we are kept by that, but we have this choice to respond to that initiated love. And so as a result of this, as a result of what he's talking about, this reality that we walk in, we must understand that we are called, we are loved, and we are kept by God. And when we understand this, Jude says, when we understand this, we will experience God's mercy and his peace and his love, not in little portions, but rather in abundance. And so this is foundational to the lives that we live. So Jude challenges us to know the foundation of our faith. And as we experience this foundation and this abundance that comes, Jude challenges the church to be watchful. Be watchful. This is actually the majority of this letter. It's this idea that we have to stand guard, to almost be like bouncers when it comes to our faith, because there are people. There are people who are coming and want to take people away from this foundation. There are teachers that are known as false teachers throughout God's word, and that we experience in our world, that in their desires, they desire to move you further and further away from this foundation that we have originally set. This is why Jude wrote this letter, right? Remember, he wrote the letter so that we would contend for a faith. Well, if we have to contend for a faith, that means that there's something that we have to contend against. And these false teachers are what we are fighting against. And so as a follower of Jesus, we need to be watchful. And this is why the content, the majority of this letter's content, is based on this challenge to be watchful. And his general kind of outline in this section is pretty unique. What he does is he describes what false teachers look like, and then he turns to the Old Testament to give examples of false teachers and the outcome of their way of life. And then he gives a word of warning. And he actually does this twice. So he gives this description, and then he gives four examples, and then he kind of gives a word of warning. Then he gives a description, he gives three more examples, then he gives a word of warning. And what I love about this passage, the chunk of this letter, is that he is not writing to the pastors of this church. He's not writing to Mark. He's not writing to me. Instead, he is writing to the church. And so, friends, this idea to be watchful does not rest simply on the pastors of the church. This rests on the people of the church, the people who are living and following their faith. Everyone who follows Jesus must be watchful for false teachers within the church. We have to be watchful. This is actually a message that I gave to my son. Different intention yesterday. We went to his basketball game, and in the midst of his basketball game, he kind of ruined his basketball shoes, and so we were going to go afterwards to get him new shoes. And so we go to Kohl's, and he's running across the parking lot. I'm like, well, you got to watch where you're going. And we no more than getting through the automatic doors of Kohl's yesterday, and I hear this big crash behind me. There's my son William. He was walking. He was enamored by the automatic doors, right? Which, you know, as a six-year-old, that was pretty cool technology, okay? And he was looking backwards at the automatic doors and missed the caution wet floor sign and just took it out, right? And it wasn't like one of those folding caution ones. It was like the one that was twice his size. It was a gigantic yellow caution wet floor sign. And my son, because he's looking backwards, did not see it and takes it out. There's this big crash. There's these people, workers are coming over to make sure he's okay. And I'm like, I told you to be, watch where you're going. Like, you know, like these are some of the hard lessons, you know, that he has to learn. Now, I was a little bit more compassionate than that. But you know, right? We have to be watchful in many areas of our lives. But perhaps the most important area is when it comes to our faith. And again, what Jude does is he shows us what we need to be watchful for. And so I'm going to read through a bunch of these verses here pretty quickly to give you a description of what false teachers look like. In Jude 4, it says this, "For certain individuals, these false teachers, whose condemnation was written about long ago, they secretly slipped in among you. They are ungodly people. They pervert the grace of our God into a license for immorality, and they deny Jesus Christ, our only sovereign Lord." Right? Verse 8, a further description. "In the very same way, on the strength of their dreams, these ungodly people, they pollute their own bodies. They reject authority. They heap abuse on celestial beings." You're seeing a thread here. And this thread is only further emphasized in verse 10 when it says, "Yet these people, they slander whatever they do not understand, and the very things they do understand by instinct, as irrational animals do, they destroy them." Right? These things, they just continue to slander the things that are beyond their understanding. Verses 12 and 13 say this, "These people, they're blemishes at your love feast, eating with you without the slightest qualm. They're like shepherds who feed only themselves. They are clouds without rain. They're blown along by the wind and autumn trees without fruit and uprooted, twice dead. They are wild waves of the sea foaming up their shame, wandering stars for whom the blackest darkness has been reserved forever." Verse 16, he says, "These people," you're getting a thread here, right? They're grumblers, they're fault finders, they follow their own evil desires, they boast about themselves, and they flatter others for their own advantage. And finally, verse 19, "These are the people who divide you, who follow mere natural instincts and do not have the Spirit." You see, continually in each of these verses, these people, Jude is showing the church that there is a group of people who are trying to lead the church away from this foundation that God has set for them. They pervert the grace of God through an immoral life. They pollute their bodies. They reject authorities. They abuse the people in the church. They make fun of whatever they don't understand. They only feed themselves. They grumble and find faults in other people. They follow their own sinful desires. They boast about themselves. They take advantage of others. They divide the church. And what I think is crazy in that list is that not a single thing in that list talks about what they teach. In other words, what Jude is saying, church, is that you can determine whether someone is a false teacher by looking at the fruit of their lives. You can see how they are following Jesus by simply looking at their lives. I just find it so wild that Jude never looks and says they're not following Paul's teaching. They're not following Peter's teaching, but instead they say, look at their lives. We need to look at the lives of the people that we are following. Jesus himself tells us that we will know a tree by its fruit, and we will know about a teacher by the fruit of their lives. And so Jude, he's taking this point very seriously. Instead of writing a letter of encouragement, he's writing a letter of warning to the church to say, do not be led astray. And what I think is interesting, he doesn't just say, avoid these people, but instead he reminds us what God does to these kind of people. And so he goes through these examples of false teachers, like what he's talking about in verses 5-7. We're not going to read through all of these examples, but he reminds the church of Israel in their rebellion against God. When after God had led them out of Egypt, they said, oh, we just wish we would have died in Egypt. And so God allowed them to go through 40 years of wandering through the wilderness before they could enter the promised land because of their false way of thinking. He gives an example of these angels from Genesis 6 who kind of left heaven and rejected God's authority and as a result kind of began to follow Satan and the devil. He looks to Sodom and Gomorrah, and which was a city in the Old Testament that was known for its evil practices. It was kind of the capital of sinful living for the Old Testament. In verse 9, he looks at this quote from not the Old Testament, but rather a different Hebrew literature book, which is called the Testament of Moses. And ultimately, he goes through the kind of the story, and he comes to this conclusion that ultimately, God will be the one who judges people for their false way of living and thinking. And then in verse 11, he further cements this understanding of false teachers by looking at Cain, who killed Abel in Genesis 4. And what's interesting is when you look at the context, Cain ended up leaving and he built a city that was defined by corruption and sin, which was the very thing that led him to kill Abel in the first place. He uses Balaam as an example. And Balaam, if you don't know the story from Numbers 22 through 25, Balaam was kind of charged to curse the nation of Israel. But instead, he was forced to give them a blessing instead. But what he ended up doing, because he hated Israel so much, he ended up luring them away to idolatry and immorality. And then he gives this example of this guy named Korah. And we read about this in Numbers 16. And Korah led a rebellion against Moses that ended in disaster for the people. And again, what Jude is doing is he's telling us, be on the lookout for these people whose lives are fruitless. And then he says, and just look at these examples from the past. All these people, their lives ended in destruction. And if you continue to follow these false teachers, this will be your future as well. And what's unique about Jude is that he gives all these examples of these extra-biblical sources. This is one of the only books in Scripture that we see all these references to extra-biblical sources. We see the Testament of Moses like a reference. We also see this book that's referenced a lot of times called 1 Enoch. All right. Now, what is important about this is that there are a lot of books that are not defined as Scripture. And what we would say is Scripture is the ultimate truth. And what Jude is kind of showing us is that there are other sections of literature, other pieces of literature that are not ultimate truth, but they are good for us to know as well. And that's what he was trying to communicate to the church here by referencing all these extra biblical things. And I love how he ends this kind of talk on being watchful, because what he does is he says, don't be surprised by this. And again, this is kind of that push to be watchful, to be ready. He says, don't be surprised. And he roots this in two different examples where people said, hey, this is coming. In verse 14 and 15, he again goes back to this letter of 1st Enoch. He says this, Enoch, the seventh from Adam, he prophesied about these false teachers. He says, see, the Lord is coming with thousands upon thousands of his holy ones to judge everyone and to convict all of them of the ungodly acts they have committed in their ungodliness and all of the defiant words ungodly sinners have spoken against him. He says, don't be surprised. God is coming to judge them at one point. And then he says also in 17 and 18, he says, not only was it talked about in the Old Testament, God will come through Enoch, but the apostles talked about this as well. He says, dear friends, remember what the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ foretold. They said to you, in the last times there will be scoffers who will follow their own ungodly desires. So ultimately, Jude's message to the church is simple. False teachers will come. Our role is to be watchful. And you may sit back and say, but I don't know everything I need to know. That's okay. He doesn't actually talk about theology at all. What he talks about is the fruit of their lives. So be looking at the lives of the leaders that you follow. It's by their words and their lives that such teachers will deny Christ. And if you follow them, you by following them will deny Christ as well. So be watchful, friends. So being watchful, it's so important, but Jude understands that there's something even more important, and he encourages the church to keep growing in their faith. Keep growing in their faith. Jude shifts from encouraging the church to be watchful to giving them a game plan on how they can grow in their faith and therefore contend for their faith. And having a game plan is important. It's significant. I remember when we were early in our married lives, we would walk into Target with no game plan. And if you know anything, that is a dangerous plan, all right? No game plan going into Target is dangerous. I would never understand why my wife would need to go up every single aisle in Target. And then we got a Costco membership. And then, yeah, see, I don't even have to say anything, right? You guys already understand. And then I understood, because now I go to Costco and I walk up and down every single aisle. I don't need a juicer, but they might have one on sale. You know, like, I don't need 57 batteries, but you never know, you know? So like, right? You need a game plan when you walk into these places. And the same thing comes true of your faith. You need a game plan. Everything in this last section here is built around this word keep. Keep. It's this Greek word tereo, and it sets up, what it does is it sets up three participles, which are like adjectives for this verb, and it's all based on building and praying and waiting. And then Jude kind of wraps it all up in verse 22 by giving us this idea of mercy, introducing this concept of mercy. And so I want to read this to you, verses 20 through 23. It says, but you, dear friends, by building yourselves up in your most holy faith, right, and praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves in God's love as you wait for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ to bring you to eternal life. Be merciful to those who doubt. Save others by snatching them from the fire. To others, show mercy mixed with fear, hating even the clothing stained by corrupted flesh. So what is Jude challenging the church to do? Jude is challenging each of us to build ourselves up. That's what he says in verse 20. We need to build ourselves up in the most holy faith. What is the most holy faith? That is the gospel, the good news of Jesus. And so what we need to do is we need to grow in our understanding of God and his word. We need to encourage ourselves regularly in the truth that is found in his word. As we do that, and as we learn about God's word, and as we understand it, we will grow and mature, and without a doubt, we will build ourselves up. Jude says that we need to pray in the Holy Spirit. He says this in verse 20 as well. He says we need to take advantage of the opportunity to pray for God's will to be done in our lives. This practice of consistent and regular prayer will keep us close to God and will allow us to build our lives on the foundation that he talked about earlier in the letter. He challenges us in verse 21 to live with eternity in view, right? He says that we need to wait for the Lord, for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ to bring us eternal life. He says we need to be expectantly looking forward to that day when Jesus will return and usher in a new reality for all of us who are following Jesus. And what that means for you and I is we need to live out our lives with not just the next 30 years in mind, but we need to live our lives with the rest of eternity in view. We need to develop in our lives an eternal perspective where we are constantly looking to Jesus. And finally, in verse 22, he reminds us that we need to be merciful. And what he's really challenging the church in is through that mercy that we are showing to one another, we are sharing the gospel with people who doubt or whose lives are going towards this way of the corrupted flesh that he talks about. So friends, if we want to grow in our faith and keep growing in our faith like he challenges us, we need to share the gospel. We need to look for ways to build a bridge with other people that can bear the weight of the gospel. We need to let people know about who Jesus is. We need to let them know about what he has done for each of us. And there is a word of caution here too. He says, listen, you need to share the gospel, but you need to make sure you're watching your own life as well, because if not, if you're too kind of flippant about it, you may be tempted to kind of walk into this life of the flesh as well. And so, friends, we need to keep ourselves in the love of God by growing in our faith, by praying and developing an eternal perspective and sharing the hope that we have in Jesus with the people around us. This is what Jude is challenging each of us to do. And what Jude is really challenging the church to understand is that God's grace demands a whole life response. It demands a whole life response where we know the foundation, we are watchful for people to lead us astray, and we grow in our faith. And you and I, we are called to know these things together. And what I love about Jude is how he ends. He doesn't end with this kind of fearful challenge, but instead he ends with a word of encouragement, a word of blessing. It's known as a doxology. And I would love to just read this doxology over you and pray as we enter into this final time of worship together. Here's what Jude says in Jude 24 and 25. He says, To him who is able to keep you from stumbling, and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. Father, we come, and Lord, this short book has incredible power. God, I thank you that your word comes and bears fruit in our lives when we lean into it. And so, Father, I pray, God, that for all of us who are here and listen to the words of your servant Jude, God, I pray that we would be men and women who would build our lives and build our faith off of the foundation that you have set for us, where you have called us, where you have loved us, where you have kept us. And Father, I pray that mercy, peace, and love would come to us in abundance as a result of that. And Father, as we go and as we live our lives, help us to be watchful for people who will lead us away from you and ways for us to grow in our faith. Help us to be watchful for those two things. And God, I thank you that our faith is not dependent upon us, but Father, as Jude said in verse 24, it's you who keeps us from stumbling. And you are the one that presents us glorious and without fault with great joy. God, may following you be a joy for each of us here. And may we live out our faiths with that same joy. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. I invite you guys to stand with us as we close with this song that just conveys the truth that in Christ alone, our hope is found. And he alone is our strength.
1, 2, 3.
Hope is found, and He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, and here in the love of Christ I stand. Good to us. We ask that you would just continue to remind us of who you are, that you are our Savior, you are our Father, you are our friend. We praise you and we thank you. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, you can grab a quick seat while I go over a few announcements, and then we'll transition and talk about that transition into the Ezra 8 portion. You'll have a chance to go if you're not able to stick around. First up, what I want to talk about is something happening for our students. They get to have all the fun. They're going on winter weekend, February 24th through the 27th. They're going to be away at Spring Hill, and it's going to be a great time. The price on that trip, that weekend trip, did I get the date right? 25th through the 27th, they're going to be at Spring Hill. The price for that is $249, but if you sign up before Thursday, it will be $50 off for an early bird special. So we encourage you to get your students registered for that. It's going to be an awesome time connecting with each other, connecting with their life group, getting to hear from a great speaker and just hearing about their about how they can grow in their faith. Those experiences for me as a youth leader, a youth pastor for about 12 years, you cannot replicate them. They are absolutely the best possible way for us to connect with each other and with God for our students. I think it's awesome. So I encourage you to get your student involved in that. Or if you know a student, get them going on that weekend. It's going to be awesome. We don't want money to be an issue. So if there is a financial issue for why you can't go, let us please come alongside and help support as a church and get your student to that weekend. We have scholarships available for that. Also, if you've been coming for a long time or if you're newer, if you're ready to take a step of getting plugged in here and becoming a part of Oak Point Canton, want to call Oak Point Canton your home, we would love to get you involved in some area of service here. I think that we grow the most when we're plugged in service, whether it's leading a life group or greeting people or having things ready or setting things up. Like we have all sorts of different areas of ministry across the church from, you know, like I mentioned, several of them from kids to greeting to all sorts of different things. We've got plenty of space and we need tech, we need musicians, we need, you name it, you think about it, we need it, all right? Because we're still a young church turning two, and we would love to get you plugged in any one of those areas of service. You can just email us at canton@oakpoint.org or stop by the desk on the way out to give us your information, and we would love to plug you in as we continue to move forward and really be the body that God calls us to be, working together with our various gifts and designs that God has given to us in order to be his church. So I just want to get you plugged in and let you know that that opportunity is always around, and we are ready and wanting to do that whenever you're ready. Ezra 8 Day is today. We've talked about it. It's our anniversary. It's our day of prayer, asking God to guide us forward into what he has next for us here at Oak Point Canton. We never want to run ahead of what God has for us. We want to wait for his guidance, his leadership, his direction. We want to stop and pause as we think about what the future holds for him to be able to lead us. And so that's what this is all about. It's us coming together. We're praying for a variety of things. And just as Ezra in Ezra chapter 8, he gathered God's people to pray for their journey. That's what we're doing right now, praying for this next year of our journey and fasting, praying together. The fasting part's optional, but some of us are fasting today just to intensify our prayers and remember that it's him we depend on each and every day. So we do this annually. We want to do this together today. We're going to pray. We're going to worship. We're going to be moving around and doing that all together. And it's going to be starting off right here in this room. So what we're going to do is we're going to take a quick pause, a quick intermission. If you have to stretch your legs or run to the restroom, or if you're not able to stick around, then that's your opportunity to hit the exits as well. But we'd love to encourage you, stick around. We're going to be moving around. We're keeping prayer moving. It's going to be an enjoyable time, I think, together for us to just ask for God's blessing and leadership on this next year. Once again, if you're staying and your kids are in the kids area and you want them to stay in the kids area, just leave them in the kids area. They'll be fine. They'll be like, oh, that was a little long today. And they'll be hanging out over there on our staff. We have people sticking around and watching kids over there as well. If you have to pick them up, then feel free to do that now. Or if you want to pick up older kids to participate, you could do that as well. So we'd love to have you stick around. If you can't, no problem. We'll set it aside for next year as well, right around this time of year. And we're just going to have an opportunity to do a lot of different things around the building this morning. So we are going to close our service with a quick word of prayer. And then in 3 minutes, we're going to be back right here. So it'll be 11:08. All right, I'm going to pray. God, thank you for what you have for us as Oak Point Canton. And Lord, I just pray that you would reveal it to us. God, that we would wait on you and your guidance and leadership and direction, Lord, and that you would go with us this week, standing our guard, as Rick shared with us this morning, and watching and guarding the truths that you have given to us through your word. Lord, that nothing would get in the way of following you first and foremost. We love you, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen. All right, 11:05 in 3 minutes. We're going to be right back here starting up Ezra 8. Thank you so much for being here.